What's important when we talk about conflict, and we relate that to creation, because of course my talks, I like to put this especially with looking at the origins of conflict from the religious side, from the scientific side, and from the physical side. When I say physical side, the actuality, I mean, like how we live our lives and how we participate, you know. So, what's important first and foremost, like I was talking about, is this fact that conflict has been embedded in the way things work, or in the way things develop. You know, it's an integral mechanism in that. So I've spoken a lot about the story of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, where, you know, yeah, there were two people who were alone with God, and of course they still managed to have a conflict between them. So that's emphasizing that conflict itself, I mean, it's unavoidable even if you live with God, you know. So that for me is very mind-boggling, because of course, as the story goes, we always say, okay, for me there's something really important about how that story went down, which is the fact that, okay, first of all, the ever-loving God, the ever-forgiving God, gets so angry with Adam and Eve. And, well, of course, they were so angry, they never forgive them. And, of course, the other part is that Adam and Eve, they never bothered to apologize to God. So, if I stay on that for a while, I have to either conclude that, okay, there was no remorse in Adam and Eve, and neither was no forgiveness in God. So it's hard to even imagine that. But of course, when we see that the ever-loving God never kind of suggested Adam and Eve not to do that again, and then just go back to their rooms or something and sleep. Or Adam and Eve maybe will just say, God, we're so sorry for what we did, we'll never do that again. So we can just conclude that in that same beginning, there were two things that are missing. One is remorse, and the other is forgiveness. So I think also when we look at the human genetically, maybe there's some things we developed on our own. We're not created with all kinds, all the different emotions, and we're not created with all the different kind of reactions that we think belong to being human. So some things, I think, we must, the human, developed on his own. The ability to say sorry, or the ability to say, okay, I will not do that again, somehow. And of course, yeah, I think it's something for the religious people to pay attention to, just that's what's missing in this story, and how, how this story has been told. So, of course, the fact that Adam and Eve left the garden, okay, they were the first two refugees that left their own home, and then they were the first occupiers of a new place, and they were the first kind of displaced people also. So, displacement, being refugee, being expelled, is part of an integral, I should say, an integral part of the beginning of how we all begin. So it should not be strange that this this transcends day to day, displacements, refugees, and expulsions, and all that. So this is about trying to understand this conflict phenomenon as a kind of tool, you know, that instigates something else to happen, or that sets up a different future, rather than the one that that's being confronted, as you say. So that can be something really to, you know, for scholars to look into. I would also like to talk about, you know, how maybe that transcends into how things are today. So we shouldn't forget that violence and this kind of chaotic setting is what governs the universe also. Well, of course, There's a mechanism that governs the universe which is really opposed to change or rearrangement, which means the planets will always be in their position and keep rotating and revolving in order to keep a kind of rhythm, in order to keep a balance. So, and this balance is caused by this incredible aggression between the planets, which means this world produces this force called gravity, pulling and pushing, keeping everybody in place. So, we have to see that when things must go together, when things have to stay together, there must be a force involved. So, either political force, dictatorial force, whatever. When two people stay together, there must be a force. You can call it love, you can call it dependency. If you want to put two pieces of wood together, as I know very well as an architect, you need glue, you need nail, you need something to hold them together. So, things just don't go together naturally. That's one fact also we should try to put into education. So, I am here, stuck here. Yes, I want to be free. Free of what? Or free from what? That would always be ambiguous because I'm stuck here by gravity. Even if I try to jump up, something draws me back down. So I'm already here by force. I have to accept that, like everybody accepts. So naturally, they're being forced to be here. But we have this psychological distortion of whatever. We want freedom, and we want, so. I think the advantage we have already is that within this physicality, we have our mind, which is the void inside, which is the space. So, I think that's the direction to go if one wants freedom or if one wants any other thing out of the physical. So, within the physicality of our existence, we are by force. So, when we look at that and how that relates also to social structure and how the structure of society is, going back to this notion of the individual within the society has his own aspiration relative to the disposition. So, that I'll talk about a little bit later. But what's important here is to know that for society to work, there has to be, inequality is the fundamental base for the formation of a society. So by that I mean, once you choose a king, the other citizens are not equal to him anymore. Once you choose a leader, we already establish a hierarchy. It's the same from the gods to the stones. So, their gods are gods, one god is more stronger than another god. From the times of the Greeks and the Romans, and even in my own culture, the European culture, there's a god of the gods. There's always this hierarchy that governs everything. So there's the sun and the planets, and there's a god and his angels and all that. So equality, once we start to talk about social structure, that is erased. So, to be equal, or the word equality by itself, it's not really what we can also imply within when we talk about a social system, because equality basically is about how two things relate. It's the product of how two things relate. So, we can take, for example, the number 2 and 6, and we can say, if we add 2 to 6, we get 8 if we subtract 2 from 6, we get 4. If we divide 2, if we divide 6 by 2, we get 3. So, and if we multiply 6 by 2, we get 12. This means every time the relationship between 6 and 2 changes, the equality changes. And that's the same way it applies to how we relate to each other. This is a more intense kind of talk, but that is something to concentrate on for in another discussion. So, based on that, I think, based on the fact that we bound to a social structure, that notion of equality is being, and you say, graded from the top to the bottom. But the society, we can also take it. It's a system. So let's look at the system. In any system in physics, we know that chaos and disorder is imminent in time. So regardless what the social system is, disorder will come in time. But at the same time, going back to this notion of how things are graded in society. So we take a system like a motor, a car, and we do have the components of the car. So we have the wheels, we have the seats, we have the engine. And eventually we have a key to start the car. So in most kind of cases, there's not one part that one can say is more important than the other. So the engine can be part of the biggest composition of a car, but without the key, it won't start. You see, like, of course, when you start the engine with the little key, well, there are the wheels, but if they don't roll, the car will move. So that's complete interdependence, and that's within the inequality of those elements. Yes, of course, you can say inequality, because a key is just a little fragment of a piece of metal, and then, of course, an engine is such a sophisticated mechanical assemblage, but needs a key, unfortunately. So, the interdependence, how everything works together, from the key and the ignition and the engine starting, and, of course, we don't forget the steering wheel and the seat. Equally as important. So that's how I would see the interdependence and interrelationship that occurs within the social system, which is what I think fundamentally the social system should be like, a system of interdependence and interrelationship. Well, the conflict aspect of this, like I mentioned earlier, is time. And with time, things always heat up. Things just always tend to go into disorder. Not because we say so, but just because that's the way things are. So the accommodation of conflict and the understanding of some of these issues that we've spoken about now, they're really important as aspects of contemporary studies of today. We do know that, of course, in this time we are part of an evolution, and maybe so, quite literally, the evolution of ourselves, because we've been, well, if we believe in that, we've transformed over the years, and now we're humans. And I do believe that that's not the end. This is not the end composition of being human. So by that I mean, there's some aspect of us really changing today, which is the genetics of that. Really, I think the notion of fear today, anger, they're a little bit different, I would like to admit, than what was. So I think we have to pay attention to that as a major factor, part of our existence of today, a kind of genetic transformation which is induced by the evolution phenomenon, and also the fact that we are in the process of change.